use JSONify and then give the dictionary inside that. But here we can just return the JSON dictionary as it is, and it will automatically get the correct format. And similarly, we have the method here, which what it does is create a to-do item on the backend server. I could have used a database, but that would have made this very difficult to explain. So we are just using an in-memory disk. And this post method, as you can see, that it creates, gets the data and stores it in the dictionary and returns the current created item. The basic difference between Flask and Flask RESTplus. Definition, what is Flask RESTplus? Stuff, it is a Flask REST API library, and it is opinionated, very opinionated, because it the documentation urges you to create API endpoints in a certain set of like techniques, like you define this, then you define this method for get request, define this method for post request. You can configure it because the code is very well documented, and it has, like, if you see the code and if you see its method, that's the code, you will see that every method has a lot of parameters. So what it helps us to do is that you can simply change the parameters, extend the code, change the parameters, you can modify it according to your need. And what I like about Flask RESTplus is that it has a very tight API description. For example, you are creating APIs and you want to describe it so that it can be read by an API tool like Postman, or if it can by an API renderer like Swagger. So those type of things are very easy. Plus, and actually they work using simple decorators, which I am going to in the later parts. And like, if you're looking for its GitHub, it's a noir wizard/fast plus, and it has around 990 plus stars. It supports both Python 2. In fact, like, it supports Python 2.7 and Python 3.3. And if you want to install it, it's available in pip -restplus. And it works perfectly with SQL Alchemy. So I'm sure, like, with Django, what we have is that we have the ORM. So for example, if you have a model, you can just do the model.all, and it works automatically. And that is not the case with Flask. But if you use Flask and use SQL Alchemy with it, which is actually very simple with Flask RESTplus, then you can use all the features of as there is in Django. So let's talk about the first feature that actually to me sells RESTplus, and it is live documentation. So for example, taking the past code that we had, a to-do app points get and post, here we have put. So you can see we have like an API, like documentation point and documentation for the put endpoint. So what do you think? How many lines of code is required to create this web page? See that it is running on localhost 5000, the default port for Flask. So I think that it might require a lot of lines, but it's very simple to it. So the steps to add a Swagger documentation to an API Flask RESTplus is very simple. We only need two steps. The first one is explicitly define input and output models. Output model is optional, but you can define it. It will be better. So what do I mean by models? This means, like, if we have a REST API endpoint, then what type of model will go inside that endpoint? So that is meant by models, and you will have to define them in the and then when you have the models defined, you will attach them to endpoints. If you have attached them to endpoints, they will be automatically documented and available on the web page like I showed here. And there is an extra step that you can do, and I am going to explain in detail about one, which is use api.doc handlers to extra information about the API. So let's see the code. Right. So it's actually very similar to what we did in the last code. So the first difference you will see is 8 to line 11. I hope it is clear. So here we are defining, and in the model we have two endpoints, like two values. The first task, which actually defines the actual task that you are going to do, and the second one, or like to make it a better example, and it is called priority. So the task two properties, task and priority. And here what we have done is that we are explicitly defining the data that is returned from the get endpoint that should be marshaled the task model. So just this. So we have the top defining the model and one line here to like declare that this model is going to interact with this endpoint, and that's all. And what it will do is that if you go ahead, this one first. So if you go ahead into, and if you expand API endpoint on the website, on the web page, then you will see that it shows that API endpoint is supposed to return this JSON model with the task. So that was around 5 lines of code addition, only 5 lines. And even better, you can just like enter the 2_ID here, and it will send a request and return you the response that is returned by an API. So it's like Postman, which is, it is like Postman, which means that it will show you all the endpoints automatically, and it will also. So I went ahead. So the next one, like we dealt with API.marshal with, which deals the response should look in an API endpoint, and there is another one which is API.expect, which like tells the user what kind of data you need to send to the Flask endpoint. So for example, in the put request, I am adding that the expect model. So the put request is also expecting that I send a data value task model, that is, it should have the field task and priority. So we can see it here. So I have expanded the put and the web page now, and you can see that it is accepting two parameters. First is to do ID, will go in the URL, right? And the second one is the payload, and if it shows that the type of payload that you can send. So it has a task, and I have written my task and priority, task being it B and priority 5, and when I send it, the request will be sent and I will get a response. Like I send a request to this URL. If you see that to-do ID is T2, so I send it to T2, and the data was this, task being eat waffles and priority is 5, and when this request was sent, I got this response. So that means that a task was created in the backend, and now use the get endpoint, and here if you add T2 here, so you will get that data. So this was this is how you document APIs in C++, and it was like if you compare this code with the last code, only of code addition, and you have this, which I think is very useful if on like a multi people working in a team, because you're doing the front end, you are doing the back end, so you want them to be aware of how your APIs are defined and how they can interact with them. So that was the basic of how to do document things, but you can do even more. For example, a decorator called api.doc, and what it allows you to do is that you define query parameters in it. So for example, you have an endpoint and you want certain query parameters. So it's very easy to define it if you just find a parameter called indent, and the description of this parameter is how many in response. And there is one more thing which is called API, and it actually allows you to document what kind of header is going to be with the endpoint, or like what kind of header you can include. This two line addition here, line 15 and line 16, and what that first see this. So we are here in this expanded the get endpoint in the web page, and if you see, there is a field for authorization in which I have added some value, and of that authorization, like how should I send a document, authorization is error space token, and we have the field for indent too, with value 4, and the description of indent is available here, like how many indents to respond do you want to send. And if you see the parameter type, the parameter is which is correct for authorization since we used api.header, and the parameter type since we used like a query, like we defined it in a query parameter sort of, indent will go in query. And now if we send a request, so it will think like it. Like we can send a request using Swagger and it will go like this. So the header to for authorization will be sent like this. And the query parameter which is indent will be sent after the question mark, like that is sent question mark indent equal to 4. So that is again only two lines of code that we needed, one for header authorization and one for the query parameter, and the functioning Swagger documentation that users can use to API and use its full features in the best possible manner. Okay, so feature of Flask RESTplus that's quite easy to use and that is like very important is creating custom errors. So for example, you are building an e-commerce application and you want to create an error, will say that there is a sale going on and there are 100 sale, and if the item is sold out, you want to return an error that this item has been sold and you want to return it to the user basically. So return a normal error using that, but using abort in Flask, you can also create a custom error and that would make the code more meaningful, like do like raise sold out error and with some value and then it will to the end user. So how to do that? First you create custom exceptions. You have the exception base class in Python. You extend the exception base class and add a couple of properties and methods so that it can be for being considered as a Flask RESTplus exception, and then you raise those exceptions in the API. For example, we have the API endpoint Flask sale, and you raise the exception that raise sold the item count is more than 100 or something, and the is to handle those exceptions, that is you attach the exception with Flask RESTplus and then it will work. So I will show how it works. So first we define an errors.py file because I don't want to define everything in one file. We want code clear. So I am creating a class called base error, which we are with exception. And we are creating one required method in here, which is to_dict. And what it says that this exception is required to be converted to a dictionary, how it should be converted. So I have added two custom fields in this exception derived class, which are self and self.code. Self.error is the error message that should be returned by this exception, and self.code is the response code, like 404, 500. So that goes in self.code. And this is my base. And then I am creating another class called notFoundError, which is derived from the base error. And in that, in the initializer, what I am setting the self.error to resource was not found, which is correct for not found. And I'm setting the code to self.code. Now that so till here we have gone to the first defining the exception. Now the second step is to raise that exception in line 17 and see line 16. So what I am doing here, if todo id is not in todos, so this will happen in a get request. For example, there is requesting some todo item that does not exist in the first place. In that case, what you can do is that if it doesn't exist, you can raise the error not found error. As simple as that. Flask RESTplus will handle it and will return the response with the appropriate response code. So for that to work, you add a simple line, method, so which is to handle the error. So like so that you can RESTplus that this error should be handled this way. So I am like pi.errorHandler for not found error, and then in this method, what I am doing is that if you get this error, what you are going to do is that in the first, use the to_dict method to convert the error to the JSON, and that is what you are going to return. And part of the tuple that you are going to return, you are going to get the code attribute of the exception, and you are going to return with that code. So, for example, if you see the not found error here, a to_dict method, and we have the code. So when this runs, response that is returned is the same dictionary which is defined here with the error message, and with get ATR get at error code, what we get is 404 because that is the code attribute in the not. So that is all, and the error will work. So if you try to and a non-existing URL on the API server, error. So I am requesting localhost 5000 to do t2 doesn't exist. So I get the response 404 with current response code 404 found and the response JSON looks like this: error, resource was not found. We defined there. So this required some work to implement, but quite short. And after I'd say around 15-20 lines, we were able to implement it. But in case you're creating a large scale application which will have errors, so the trade off is not that much, because once you define, you practically use them anytime, anywhere you want. The third cool feature of Flask RESTplus is request parse. You can parse request values from query parameters, from headers, from cookies, very simple using a single line of code. So what do you do to do this? First, request parameters. So for example, you want to access this cookie. So you define it at one place, and then but you can document them so that they are visible on the web page in the Swagger UI, is that you parse and use them, right? So we are going with the same code. In the line 8 and 9, we are defining a parser, rec parse dot request parser. The parser has been defined now, and then we add the argument to ID should be accepted. So we have the root here. Notice that I have changed the root. Earlier the root was /todoid. But now it is simply /todo, because I am going to to ID using a query parameter. So I have documented the query parameter api.doc, and then I have defined it like it's equal to todo ID, and the description of this is that ID of todo. So todo ID means ID of. And in line 15, I am going to use the parser to parse that argument todo ID, and it returns a dictionary. So I am using to use the square JSON to get the todo ID value and store it in the todo ID variable, and then return the todo item. So again, we had additions in as part of line 8, 9, line 13 to query parameter, and line 15 to parse the query parameter. So 4 lines of addition, and we can accept a query parameter in Flask RESTplus. Obviously comes with the documentation. So if you go to now, it will show as /todo. And it is showing that there is a query parameter into this endpoint. Its description is ID of todo. You give the value t1 here, because it is already defined that t1 exists. So, and if you send the work, and you will get the response. So you can define different type of like, have the parser detect different type of requests. For example, if you want to the value in the form, so what you can do is parser.addArgument name in the location form. Same goes for query parameters, where you can use the arcs. And for like headers, what you can use is that location headers. So here we are doing parser.addArgument. We have the name as user-agent, which is quite common, and then we define the location as headers. So once we do that, then what we can do is that we can just call parser.parsearcs that we did here. We can have this value as user-agent, because it will be available in the dictionary. And then we will have the value of user, as simple as that. And we can also get cookies from the parser. Just define the location as cookies for the variable, and then it will work. So that was about getting the values of the request. And we can also extend this concept to use for authentication. For us, you might know that authentication generally works based on headers. You send a header, the backend verifies the header, and then it sorts of authentication. So the way to do it is, like, we are doing basic authentication here. What we will do is that we will request first set up request parsing for the header, like we did in the last part, and then we will document the header, and then we'll include the authentication. So again, going with the same code, we have defined the request parse, and then what we are going to do is that we are going to define a header JSON, give the type of it as string, and define the location as headers. Instruct Flask RESTplus to look into the headers dictionary for the authorization variable, and once it has that, we pass it out of the using the parse arcs method. So we will have the authentication value in the auth variable. We can compare it, like if auth equal to some secret key the user to send, then return the normal value. Otherwise, you can just abort. Again, we have documented it using the api.header like decorate. It will be available in the web page. If you go into the Swagger documentation, here we undefined, and it's not that clear, but I am sending the value as base secret, which we had defined in the code. And when I send it, then you can, the request goes through, and I get this body, that is T1, some that I had already defined here. So since I'm correct value of authorization, so this condition matches true. And so what happens if I send a wrong header? So I'm defining the authorization header as basic wrong secret, which is obviously a wrong header value. And when it goes through, you see the this message. You don't have permission to access the requested resource. Now, default, it happens like Flask and Flask RESTplus, they handle it by default. So the last concept that I'm going to is about pagination. This is something that is not available in the Flask library yet. But like since I was making a full-blown API, I had to create it because it was needed. So pagination, a paginated API response generally looks like this. You have a variable, a count value that shows the total number of items that exist. You have a limit value that will show that how many items do you expect like given out in a single page. You have the next value which show that which like shows us that the next request that get the next page. Then you have the previous value which is kind of empty here in a minute why. And we have a results array which stores the list of items that are going returned as per the response, and we have the start value. Why do people use pagination? I think we should clear that up first. So for example, high scale application that has 10,000 items in the database, and if you are returning it in one go, that will mean that there is going to be a large network request. It will take a lot of time. So what do you generally want to do? What you do is that you return 20 items, and when the user scrolls down, you return 20 more like that. So pagination comes into play. So in that case, what you will have is that you will have the limit set to 20, count as 10,000 because we have a lot of items. And the next value reflect the next page that you want to fetch. And once you keep on requesting, it will work. So the pagination algorithm required a lot of else conditions. That is like too much to show in this presentation. If you want the code, it is here, is.gg/pagination-restplus. I will give the link to the slides at the end, so no worries. What you do in that algorithm is that you get the list of items that you have to paginate. One, so for example, we have 10,000 items. I get a list of 10,000 items that I paginate. And then I am going to dissect that list. I mean, break the list according to the start at limit values. For example, so the list is of 10,000 items. The start is set to 60 and the limit is 20. So I need the list items from to 80, right? So I will add some logic so that it divides the list so that only 61 to 80 items come into it. I will build a previous and next URLs that we saw here using the same logic. What I will do is that I will increment the start by list to create do that, and then create this structure and return it. So let's suppose that we have the function which is present here. So how to interact with the code? So first you import that function. This is in line 3. What you do is that you add 2 request parameters, because now we will be needing the parameters start and limit. So like it says that when the at which page should I start returning the response, and then there is this limit which says that how many maximum values to return. Once I have defined the request parameters, I can just parse it. Been doing already in line 17. And I can use this method, will return the response in a paginated based form. Notice that I am sending the to it. So args means this start and limit. It is a dictionary of start and limit values. So this function automatically handles the logic of like dividing the to-do list so that only values within the start and plus limit is returned. So let me show how it looks in action. So here we have, we are sending a request to point with the query parameter start and limit. Start is set to 2, limit is set to 1. Since 1, it means that I only need to return one item needed response. Like this is not used generally, but I am using it showcase here. So when I set the start to 2, you will only one item is returned, which is of ID T2, which is the second task. the limit is set to 1, T3 is not returned because we can only return one page. And we have the next set, localhost 5000, to do start equal to 3 and limit equal to 1. Value will respect the limit value, so it automatically starts from next page, and the previous is set to start equal to 1 and limit equal to 1. So request to this URL, you will automatically get T1. So it works. The logic is like, it has a lot of if-else condition. It was 40-50 lines, so if you want it, it's here. So that is how a paginated response request looks like. Like I have worked with Flask RESTplus and did lots of interest using it, and I'm not covering that in this presentation because I'm out of scope of it. It would have required too much time to explain. Most of it is basically based on algorithms, lots of logic. So I don't think a sense in explaining that. If you like, three blocks on it. So the first one is about creating multiple using decorators in Flask RESTplus. So, like for example, aha, scaled production ready web application, it has ways of authentication. Like one could be based using basic authorization, other could be WT tokens, one could be based using API token keys. So we can think of different ways to authenticate. And if you want to do support multi-authentication in your backend, then I will recommend that you read this blog. And another thing is, like, if you want to validate input using plus, it is not automatic. For example, if you have a field and you want the username field to be between 6 to 20 characters, and it should not at the rate. So those type of things you can do in Flask RESTplus. It requires some. It is very easy to do so. Around 10-20 lines of code, you add it, and you will be able to do so. So for that, visit this blog. And for the third one is a tool which is about creating dynamic output in APIs. So what I mean by dynamic output, so for example, if we have a user endpoint that returns whole user data. So for example, I am that user and I am requesting that endpoint. So obviously I should get myself. Like I should get my phone number, I should get my email, I should get my social security. I have the right to be able to access that. But suppose you are that user and you are accessing my information. So you should not get my email ID or security number. So in this case, what people generally do is that they create a points, one for getting general user information and one for getting the user information. But it is possible to do that in a single API request, in a single API endpoint. And for that, you have to do is that you will have to write some logic and change data that is returned by the API using some logic. So I have written a blog on that. It's of logic, so I'm not going to cover that, and it's available here. So that's pretty much it. And if you have access to the talks code, the code that I have used here, it is at this link, and the link to the slides are also available in this link. Like it is a GitHub repo, so if you go there, if you see the README, we have the link to the slides in that. And I am here in the conference, so if you have any questions, you can ask. Or if you have any questions now. I think we have 5 minutes.
Any questions?
This means that we don't have to care about grouping anymore with the flask RESTplus. Normally, when I wrote the flask Python flask code, I split controller into multiple blueprint. I just use the resource class instead of, isn't it?
You just use the resource class. So I think, that is a good way too. But in Flask RESTplus, we have a class for namespace too. So it would be better if you use namespace over resource, because that provides sort of a hierarchy. So for example, if you want to create like multi-version APIs, API slash V1, API slash V2, API slash V3. So that is a better way to.
Thank you.
There might be any examples of the work that you've done with RESTplus that you can mention, like what kind of projects has it been that you worked on?
What kind of projects?
Yeah, like what is the scale? What is it, what is the area for? What kind of people did you do it for? You
know? So, like, we generally have companies, startups, companies, and. Like I have specified that my interest, my expertise, so I mostly do that type of projects. And like my specialization is actually backend, so like I work backend if needed or if there is an opportunity for creating a full stack application, I take that too. So like if you're asking what kind of projects, most of it is like data based where we have to create like an e-commerce or an event management or and with has some data.
Anyone else?
Normally I use Django and because of I have to use database. In your case is a Flask RESTful API. So what kind of database or what kind of library that you use to get the state of your data?
Okay, so like we have an extension for Flask called Flask SQL Alchemy, and it what it allows to do is that it will help you use SQL Alchemy library. SQL Alchemy library, you can use any SQL database like SQLite, Postgres, any SQL, everything works. And if you integrate like a Flask RESTplus with Flask SQL Alchemy, you will be able to use the database just like Django. So we will have an ORM can do like model.objects.all, everything will work like Django.
So by that, what is the benefit between use Flask RESTful with a third party of database comparing to Django and Django REST? What is the benefit? Is any performance benefit over that?
Yeah, I get it. So like, see, Django comes with a lot of bootstrap code. There is a lot of things like urs.py, settings.py, it's overall more complex. So in case you're looking to create a simple project and looking to have more control over it, since Flask is a very minimalist framework and yes. Flask RESTplus is too, so it allows you to have more control over how the APIs are defined. So in case you favor that, then you can go with Flask.
Okay, thank you
it's
very
more
much.
Of a philosophy.
Yeah, I used to use Flask framework to cooperate with AP scheduler as another backend use dedicated database. It's totally different from Django. Yes, I use it that way. Thank you very much.
Yeah,